Good morning to you. Maybe you don't know who I am, but I am a member of this church. And if I'm not here, it's because I'm out preaching in other churches. Because we have a number of small churches around, and the pastor has maybe two or three churches, sometimes four. So they need some help here and there. And I call this sermon the last day message. And it might be a little different than what you thought it would be. But I want to make it positive for you and encourage you in the Lord. Now, when Mary Magdalene, she was at the tomb on resurrection morning. Mark says, she said, Jesus is alive. And John says, I have seen the Lord. Well, of course, the disciples, they didn't believe anything she said, but that was the good news. I have seen the Lord. He had risen. So throughout the New Testament, the disciples and Paul, they were asked to go and preach the good news to people. That old English is God's spell, and that's where you have the word gospel. Greek is evangelium. It means good news. Now, in Christ Object Lessons 415, it says, the last message and mercy to be given to the world is a revelation of his character of love. And God's children are to reveal what the grace of God has done for them. Now, our bulletin on the back side is a mission statement. And it took a long time at the church board to come to an agreement on what we should write in the bulletin. But it goes right along with this. It's very good. To experience God's end time message of love and share it with the community. That's fantastic. It's right on. That is the last message of the world. Share God's love and share it with the community. So, it's not the 2300 evenings and mornings that is necessary. When you talk to the neighbor, they don't need a lecture on what happens at the State of the Dead. You don't have to go Catholic bashing. But you have to tell them the good news. Why wouldn't you want good news on a day like today? When gas prices are going through the roof, and grocery prices are going the same way, and you know, it just looks awful. We need some good news. Not only talking about it, but living it. Like helping the poor and the needy. Encourage them, lift them up, give them a boost. Bring back some sunshine in their life. Read for them, pray for them, bring them to Jesus, because we should be channels of God's love for our neighbors. And the next page in Christ Object Lesson, the light of the sun of righteousness is to shine forth in good works, because Jesus went around doing good. Next page, 417. In the night of spiritual darkness, God's glory is to shine forth through his church in lifting up those who are bowed down. relieving and softening life's hardship and misery. Well, practical work, clothing the naked, shelter for the homeless, bring back the sunshine. Speak to them words of cheer and pray. Now, I was laying on a couch, some friend's home in the mid-Atlantic. It rains there every day, all the time. It's cloudy, overcast, gloomy. And this is why I remember this verse in Isaiah 60. The Spirit of the Lord of God is on me, because the Lord has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. Sorry. We are one page off. Arise and shine, your light has come, and the glory of the Lord is on you. Darkness covers the earth, total darkness the people, but the Lord will shine over you, and his glory will appear over you, and nations will come to you. That's our job, to be a light, to be sunshine, to help somebody. I was living up in the Arctic for 3 years. And during the winter, you know, the sun doesn't rise at all. It gets kind of gloomy. And I had a big spotlight that we use for taking movies. And I would just turn it on. It ran 1,000 watts. I'd just hold it out like this and had it shine on me. Oh, there's light somewhere. Oh, it's wonderful. Oh, I'm at the beach in California. Oh, it's just fantastic. Then you turn it off and back to the gloom. So we try to talk to Jesus, what Jesus has done for me, how Jesus helps me in my daily life. You don't have to hit them over the head with the 28 beliefs, because that's a heavy book. It might hurt somebody. And you don't have to tell them about running to the mountains and hiding in the caves. That's not good news. And many times people have come up to me and asked me, how are we going to run to the mountains? I said, I have no clue. You can't even walk to the mailbox. lots of books are printed at the Pacific Press. And there's a big section about 6 foot wide right in the center when you walk in to ABC on the end times. And I asked them, why do you print so many books on the end times? Because they sell. Adventists just love to scare themselves at what's going to happen in the end time. That's not good news. There are people who build houses north of Spokane and a little to the west. Lots of Adventists live up there on 160 acres, fully contained mansions where they can hide out at the end time. That's not good news. That's not what we are told to teach people. Got to tell them some good things about Jesus. We're living at a time when everything is going south, and people need some good news. I would like to tell you what I think of Jesus, because I found in him a friend so good and true. I will tell you that he changed my life completely. He did something that no other friend could do. No one ever cared for me like Jesus. There's no other friend as good as he. No one else could take the sin and darkness from me. Oh, how much he cared for me. Oh, you go over to your neighbor and you sing for them. It's not a bad idea. You might like a different song, I don't know. People need some good news. Now, I was in the military. In Denmark, it's compulsory. Everybody has to go for 1 year. And so here I'm in a room with 10 or 12 others. None of them are Christians. One is a biologist, one is a university student, one is a plumber, one is a woodworker, one is pushing numbers, and so all different kinds of people. And we're just sitting there talking, and they knew I was a Christian who went to church. So they said, can you prove there is a God? That's a good question. Well, I said, this is what God has done for me. I said, I was deadly sick when I was 12 years old. And a friend of mine also got the same disease. He died. They put him in an iron lung and it misfunctioned on the way to the mainland on the airplane. And I said, my father, he called all the church members on this island and they all prayed for me and God saved me. I said, doctor couldn't do it, but God did it. And I said, I'd lose something and I can't find it. And I asked God to help me and I find it. Thank you, Lord. Or I have a problem and I don't know how to solve it. And I ask God to help me, and he solves the problem for me. And I think that he's going to answer this way, but he usually answers in a different way. And it comes from a different direction than I expected. But he answers me. You know, they can't argue with what happened to you. And I wasn't going to get in an argument in the Bible. I was just telling him, this is what God has done for me. That's why I go to church, and that's why I worship God. Well, they would come to me and ask me. They knew I was going to be a minister. So here's this friend. I used to drive home with him in his little car. He has had a Morris Minor. You know what that is? It's like a golf cart. But it drives fantastic, but you're like you're sitting on the road, you know, it's so low. So he said, I have a question for you. Yeah, I said, what is it? What's the symptoms of gonorrhea? So I gave him all the symptoms. And he said, what do I do to get healed from that? I said, you go upstairs to the doctor. He'll give you 2 million international units of penicillin. And he'll do the same 3 days later, and in a week, you'll be fine. Well, that's what we did back in those days. They might have a different treatment today. And he said, okay, that's not going to be good. I said, what? Well, I'm supposed to go home tonight. He had a wife and 2 kids. And if I can't have sex, because then she will have gonorrhea too. And then I have to tell her what happened, and she's going to kill me. No, I said, this is what you're going to do. And you tell her exactly what I'm telling you. You tell her I was in a bad end of town. And this is a place in Denmark that was called Nyhavn. It's about 3 blocks, one bar next to the other, and second story, all the prostitutes live up there. The police don't walk 2 by 2 there, they walk 4, or they get rolled over and pushed into the canal. It's a rough place. Well, he said, I was just totally wasted with alcohol, and I hooked up with two prostitutes, and they came in my car. I don't know how that worked. It's such a small car. And then they threw up all over the car. It took him 2 days to clean that up. And he said, I got gonorrhea. All right, I said, this is what you tell her. I got wasted. It was a terrible mistake. I was completely drunk and out of it. I hooked up with two prostitutes. And he said, I got gonorrhea, and I'm on doctor's care right now, and I'll be okay in 1 week. He said, it's a terrible sin. I'm so sorry that I did it. I will never do it again. And I said, she's going to forgive you right there. Oh, no, he said, she's going to kill me. I said, no, she won't. And don't you tell her any details, just what I told you. So he did. And she forgave him and kissed him, and they lived happily ever after. When they got backed up in a corner, and they didn't know what to do, they come to me. And I said, what do you do? I said, this is what you say, and this is what you do. They know I was not lying to them, and I was a Christian, and that would help them. I was studying physical therapy at a hospital in Copenhagen, and that was my father's idea. He forced me to become a physical therapist. I wanted to be a minister. So there goes 4 years out of my life. And then 1 year in the military, that's 5 years. And then finally I got to go to theology and do that. So here I am at this hospital. I'm in a gymnasium, and there's a guy sitting in there playing at the grand piano the blues. Now, we sang together in a quartet, which was fantastic. Like he told me later, that's the only thing that was worth living for when we went through school, all the singing we did. But he never played the blues. So I walked over, I sat on a piano bench, and I said, there's something wrong. You never play the blues. There's some trouble here. Yeah, he said, that's for sure. Ola, he said, I got two girls pregnant. I don't know which one to marry. And what does the Bible say about that? I said, you can forget what the Bible says. You've done that already. Now you got to figure out which girl you're going to marry. And we sat there and talked with her for a long time, and we had prayer, and I met him 6 years ago. 50 years later, he's still married to the same girl. Yeah, it turned out good. Then I was sitting in my room at this place. My father's office was downstairs, right underneath my room, and he was the chaplain of the hospital. My mother's office was to the other side. She was in charge of all the students and all the workers, about 300 of them. And he should have gone and talked to my father, but he knew that would not be good. So he came up and talked to me. He was kind of a rough guy, rough language, born on the wrong side of town. But my father often said, why do you have so many weird friends? I don't know, that's just the way it was. So he comes in, I got a question for you. He's a rough kid. His girlfriend was the best one around to give abortions to people. and she could do it with a knitting pin. So, you know, this little rough community. If my parents had known that, they would have kicked half of the school out. All the stuff that was going on. So I don't know what he's going to ask me. Then he says, what do I do to be saved? I almost fell off the chair. Have all things for him to say. What must I do to be saved? So I told him. And a few years later, he was the head elder of his own church at home in his country. You tell him what God has done for me. And when we were in the third world in the mission field, and I was out traveling, I'd stop at all the different missions that have been sent out, some by the Baptist Church and some by the churches that speak in tongues, and sometimes it was two or three different denominations that had sent out a missionary, and usually they were discouraged. And so I'd go in and talk to them. I would sing with them. I would pray with them. I would share stories of how God has helped, and they were so happy. Oh, they praised God that I had stopped and talked to them and bring a little sunshine into their life. And I tell them, you know, quotes from the Bible. And this is what you can do. You find some quote that you like, that really speaks to you. Now you learn it by heart. So you don't have to read it out of the book. You learn it. Then you think about what you want to say, maybe a sentence or two after that. So I learned this from Joe Milashenko. He said, you've got to have all this prepared ahead of time. So when I come in, and sometimes I was visiting with pastors, or sometimes regular people, I'd say, you know what? I have a special verse in the Bible that I really like. It's found in Psalms. It's right in the middle of the Bible, chapter 34. And it's repeated four times in Psalm 34. But I like verse 19 the best. And it says, many are the troubles of the righteous, but God delivers them out of them all. I said, that's wonderful. I like that. And no matter how far down we get, no matter how depressed we get, God will come and deliver us from all of it. Amen. So that's how you can use a verse like that. Now, in Mark 5, 19, Jesus is over by Decapolis, and he has just thrown out 2,000 devils out of a man who lived there among the tombs, and he dressed him, and he was in his right mind, and he's sitting there in front of Jesus, and Jesus is teaching him. And then the whole town comes out, and they ask Jesus to leave. I never figured out why on earth would they ask him to leave. They were afraid of him. Maybe because he had power over these demons, and they lost 2,000 pigs. I don't know. So he left. He goes in the boat, and this man wanted to go with Jesus. And Jesus says, no, you're not going. I tell you, if I had said that to somebody, my wife would say, don't you say that. You take him with. He wants to be with you. Well, she wasn't there, so. Jesus says, you go home and you tell everybody what God has done for you. He did. And next time Jesus came by Decapolis, Deca means 10, polis means city, the 10 cities. Next time Jesus came there, everybody wanted to hear what he had to say. So his witness was worth a lot. And that's the only thing Jesus asked us to do. Go home and tell what God has done for you in your life. So 2 days ago, I was driving my son's truck. He's a beekeeper. And so I used to drive truck when I was young. I had to go and get a load of something. And they loaded it for me. I paid for it. And now I have to strap it down. And I got the straps out and threw it up and lost it up on top. And I thought, well, now I have to go get it. So I figured out I could maybe get up from the back. I could step on the hitch and then on the bumper, and I might make it up there. And then I thought, if I get up here, I'm not going to make it back down. And I've been praying God to help me. Lord, help me when I drive. Might have an accident. Might have a breakdown. Always pray that. In fact, I pray more today than I have ever prayed. Maybe that's wrong. I don't know. Sometimes I apologize to God for asking for so many favors and praying. But he did say, ask and you shall receive. You know, it's his own fault. And he says, come unto me, those who are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. So you ask for it, and that's why I pray. And in heaven, he's going to give me a new name. He's not going to call me Oli. I'm sure he's going to call me the beggar. Here comes the beggar. That's okay. I'll live with it. So I'm sitting there behind the truck, and a man walks up. Oh, he said, you need some help with strapping down the load. Oh, I said, guy, you're an angel from God. Oh, no, he said, I wouldn't go that far, but he strapped it down and no problem. He said, thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you. That's just wonderful. Matthew 13, the good news must be proclaimed to all nations. In Luke 4, Jesus is in Nazareth, and he is reading out of Isaiah. Scroll. Isaiah 61. There are no chapters, there are no verses, it's just one solid thing. It's about 30 feet long. You can see it for yourself. It's in a museum in Jerusalem. I got the whole scroll out there. You can buy a copy of it for $30,000. So you know it's the Jews who have it. Well, so Jesus was reading out of Isaiah 61. The Spirit of the Lord is on me. He has anointed me to preach good news to the poor, to heal the brokenhearted, liberty to the captives, freedom to the prisoners, comfort all who mourn. And then you can add to it two chapters over in 58. Set the oppressed free. Tear off every yoke. Share your bread with the hungry. Bring the homeless into your house. Clothe the naked. I was living up in Greenland, and we needed some Dorcas clothes. And I thought, you know, we need some thick stuff. It's cold up here. And so I got in touch with Iceland. They had a big Dorcas, and they had lots of clothes. And I said, I would like to have all the stuff you have. I'm going to send an airplane and pick it up. So I wrote a letter to the U.S. Navy, because they had a base in Greenland. And I said, it would be very nice if you would send a C-31 over to Iceland and pick up the Dorcas clothes and bring it back to me. I mean, people would look up to you and they would thank you. This is a nice gesture by American government. So they did. I said, unfortunately, we don't have any landing strip. We have a heliport, and there's a field next to it. So if you fly over with your C-31, open the back door, and just kick it out, I'll pick it up. I'll have a truck down there. So he came over with this huge airplane. You know, everybody's looking. And they open the gate, and out comes all these big, about this wide, boxes in fall to the ground, and they cruise around again, and here comes, and they kept doing it until they had unloaded everything. And then we brought it home to the church, and we were giving out Dorcas clothes every week on Tuesdays. Whatever they asked for, we'd give it to them. You walk down the street, and most kids were wearing Dorcas clothes. And most women were wearing Dorcas clothes. Somebody here from Dorcas saying amen? Because the men were drinking up all the money. And so they were so happy that we could give them this stuff. I had a head elder in a church in California. His name was Tewksbury. You should never mention people's names from the pulpit, but that was his name. Unfortunately, his wife ran out on him, and the second wife ran out on him. But I loved him. He was a wonderful man. He dedicated his life when he retired to go and help people, especially widows, or young mothers with children, somebody who had no money. He would fix their cars, or he would fix their plumbing. He was good at both things, free, including parts. That's nice. That's what we're supposed to do, do something good. There was another family in our church there, and they would go shopping. They'd fill their whole station wagon with grocery bags. They would back up to a person's door and they would unload the whole thing in on the kitchen counter, saying, this might come in handy for you. Yeah, you're not kidding when you don't have anything. They would invite people out to the restaurant, people who couldn't afford to go, just to cheer them up a little bit. Some person in the same church would go out and give a family a pass to SeaWorld or Animal Park. Now, I know we have a zoo in Boise, but that's a joke. You can see more of the animal from outside than from the inside. You know, it's. But you go down to the animal park now, it's a whole day experience. It's a fabulous place. And they would give this pass to the family so they could take their kids and enjoy life because they didn't have money to do it, just to cheer them up. Or you can take a loaf of bread to a neighbor. And so here my wife is, and she's walking out the door with a loaf of bread. I'm taking it over to the neighbor. I said, bad idea. No, she said, that's what we do. No, I said, it's a bad idea. Oh, she said, I'm going to invite him for Bible study. I said, that's a worse idea. I said, don't you know that this lady, she's into Buddhism and Hinduism, have nothing to do with the Bible. It's not going to go. Well, she went anyway. I couldn't talk her out of it. So she goes over there, here is a loaf of bread that I just baked. And she was so thankful for it. And she said, how would you like to come to Bible study? No. Well, I told her that was going to be the response. How about if you come one time to Bible study? No. So they were talking back and forth. They were really nice people. They were younger than we were, and just good people, except she was a Buddhist. Actually, they were hippies. They looked like hippies. They ate like hippies. They lived like hippies. I mean, they had the bathtub out underneath an oak tree. A toilet was sitting on another oak tree. They're real hippies. You don't see that every day. So my wife comes home, and he says, well, how did they go? Oh, they're coming for Bible study on Monday night. No, I said, I don't think so. Yeah? I said, how did you finagle that? Well, he said, finally I got down to, if you come to Bible study one time, my husband, he's going to give you the Bible study. And if you don't like it, we will never talk about it again. So she said to me, you're going to give the Bible study on Monday night, and if she doesn't like it, or her husband, we'll never talk about it again. I said, I don't like that kind of a setup. It's not nice. Now all the burden is on me. If they never come back, it's my fault. I don't like it. So here we go, Monday night. I'm laying on the floor, on my stomach. I'm running a projector. I'm showing them pictures from the Dead Sea Scrolls, from the British Museum in London, how God has preserved the Bible over the years, that this is actually God's word. It is the same you read in your Bible as was printed or handwritten 200 years before Christ. Well, of all things, they liked it. And so they kept coming back, whole family. Got baptized. First they got married. Then they got baptized. And once in a while she calls us and she says, there's not a day that goes by without me thanking the Lord for all the stuff that you taught us. How do you like that? For a loaf of bread. That's all we asked to do, something nice for people. I remember one man, he said, I'll help you get a license. The guy was selling flowers down in the corner, and the police had thrown him away. He didn't have a license. He went to City Hall, he got the guy a license, he got a picture he could put on his stomach with license number and everything. He helped him set up a shed so he could sell his flowers. And it was a booming business. Every Friday, the guy with the flowers, he would come with a bunch of flowers and give it to this family who had helped him. He was so thankful. You know, maybe you lived in Caldwell for a long time. You know a lot of people in town, and then some new person comes in, help them to get a job. Oh, you know, I have this one over here. They'll probably give you a job. I'll go with you. I have done that. Sometimes you get burned, you know. You get them a good job, and then they don't show up, and they don't do what they're supposed to do, and you thought they were really good Christians, and they look real holy when they go to church, but they're not very good at the job, so I'm looking bad. That's okay. They're not all that way. Most are very good, and most are very happy, and you help them get a job. Maybe they don't have a car. They need to be driven to appointments. And this lady in our church, she didn't have a car, and she was praying all the time, "Oh Lord, help me with my driving and somebody to take me to the store and the bank." And she's always praying that. I said, "Why do you pray this prayer? You don't like my car? Do you want a Rolls Royce? Is that what you're praying for?" I said, "I take you every week to the store, to the bank." So finally she stopped that. Maybe you could invite somebody home for dinner so they know that somebody loves them. Somebody wants to help them. Maybe you want to pray with people, you know. They're depressed, they're down and out. They just need some encouragement. "Let me pray with you." It feels good when people say that. Don't make a long prayer, just a short prayer, that God will be with them and encourage them and help them. Then you quote a little Bible verse for them. But this is what God wants us to do, as we read here in our statement, to experience God's end time of love and share it with the community. You're not supposed to do a whole lot of other stuff, but do that. Just be friendly. If we are really friendly, this church would be packed full, wall to wall. That's what people are looking for, especially this time when everything is really gloomy. Now we'll sing a wonderful song about "Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus."
Thank you.
You know, we sit in our daily life and we look around. Doesn't matter where you look, there's trouble everywhere. Depressed, don't know how to solve problems. Look up. Look up to Jesus, because he's got the solutions for everything you have. And that's why we sing this song, Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus. Dear Lord and Heavenly Father, thank you for being our Father. Thank you that we can come to you. Thank you for helping us. Oh Lord, help us also to be a friend to our neighbor, to those people we meet, that we can share your wonderful love with them. We thank you in the name of Jesus. Amen.